In this video, we'll learn how to use Cloudflare Workers to interact with your R2 storage buckets. Cloudflare Workers are functions that run on Cloudflare's edge network, allowing you to perform different operations on your R2 storage bucket. In addition to accessing your R2 storage bucket directly from the dashboard, you can also do the same using Cloudflare Workers. You can use Workers to automate tasks and integrate R2 storage into your applications. Before we get started, let's make sure we have everything we need. First, we need to install Wrangler, a command line tool for managing and deploying Cloudflare Workers. To do this, enter the following command to install Wrangler globally. After that, ensure you have the correct version by running Wrangler version command, which will show you the current version you have installed. Next, Wrangler will need to access a Cloudflare auth token to manage workers' resources. Enter the command Wrangler login to grant Wrangler access to your worker resources. A new tab will open to complete the login process. Select Allow after you log into your account, and your auth token will be configured so that you can start using Wrangler to manage your workers' resources. Now let's create a worker. You can do that using the command Wrangler init and your worker name. This will prompt you with some questions. You can either respond to yes or no, and then finally your project will be created. To start developing your worker, open your project in VS Code and run the command npm start. This will start up the development mode and will prompt you to select one of the accounts you'd like your worker to be deployed to. We see that we have our worker running, so next let's create our R2 bucket. We'll be using the command Wrangler R2 bucket create and the name of the bucket we'd like to create. After that is created, you can use the Wrangler R2 bucket list to see all the buckets you have in your account. The next step is to bind your buckets to a worker. In Cloudflare Workers, a binding is how your worker interacts with external resources like R2 buckets or KV namespaces. The binding is defined in the Wrangler configuration file, where you need to specify a valid binding and add your bucket's name. The binding is used to reference the bucket inside of your worker's code. Next, open the index.ts file and let's start writing the code. Set the correct binding name for your R2 bucket, and then we'll create a new URL from the request.url property and extract the key for the R2 operation by removing the leading slash in the path name. Next, we'll create a switch statement to perform CRUD operations on our buckets. The first case is a put request. This writes any key that we have in our request to your R2 bucket. Once that is done, a response is returned. Following that, you have the get request, where you're also trying to get the objects that you stored already in your bucket, but also we want to check if the object actually exists. So if it exists, fine, return it. If it doesn't, we want to return a status of 404. Also, in order to read a request from the bucket, you need to assign headers to it. So here I'm just doing that, setting the etag header on the request, and then finally returning a response with a 200 status. Lastly, we have a case statement. This is used to delete any entry that we've entered in our bucket using the delete method from R2. And then once that is done, you get a response back, and the default statement actually checks the method. If it's not a get, put, or delete request, it should return a 405 error. Allowing every incoming request to interact with the bucket could create a security vulnerability, allowing anyone to access the bucket and also modify its content, which is not what we want. So let's go ahead and set up bucket access and privacy settings for this worker, allowing only authorized requests to access or modify the contents of the bucket. We'll set up an allow list constant that only specifies what file in our bucket we want to be able to access. Next, we'll create a has valid header function. This function will check if the request being made comes with a header called X custom key, and also will check if it matches the secret key we've created. And for this, we'll need to create a secret key later on, and I'll show you how to do that. But for now, just call the auth key secret, and following that, we'll create another function called authorize request. What this is going to do is it will create different case statements for both the put and the delete and the get
method. The put and the delete checks if it has the valid header. So if the header has a auth token assigned to it. The get statement will check if the key in our request matches the allow list value. Finally, you have a default statement that returns false if any of this is not passing. The authorize request function is then called in the fetch function to determine if a request is authorized before performing any of the CRUD operations. Great, now that we have our application, let's run it locally. Unfortunately, it won't work. This is because you need a out to preview bucket separate from the one you have for production. So what we will do is we'll create a dev bucket using the Wrangler R2 bucket create command, but we'll create a separate bucket. So for this, I'm calling it dev, and then go back to your Wrangler configuration file and add a preview bucket name there, assigning the name of the bucket you just created. Now try running the command again. It should work now. One more thing we need to do is create the secret key that we have in our code. So I'm going to go ahead and do that with the Wrangler secret put command. And once I'm done, I'll publish my worker. Once you publish your worker, you get a URL with the workers.dev domain that you can now use to test your application. So let's try testing our application using curl. The first request I created failed because I didn't set the auth secret. Doing that will successfully write a new entry in my bucket. Here I'm trying to get that entry and it returns great because it has the correct allow list name set. If I try to do otherwise, it fails. This is my bucket with the file that I've just uploaded in it. Everything works as expected, and I can also try to delete it using the delete method. That's it. We've created an R2 bucket using Cloudflare Workers and uploaded content to it. If you'd like to learn more about how R2 storage can help you build more performant applications, check out the links in the description below.